Harshit Sahay from Duke University. Please.
Oops. Okay, so good afternoon, and thanks to the organizers for giving me the opportunity to present today. And so I'll be continuing on the same theme of protein-DNA interactions, but sort of looking at transcription factor binding and the work that we've been doing to understand how they bind to DNA with mismatches and why we think it's important to think about in the creation of mutations. So we start by looking at sort of cancer mutations in whole genome data that's been recently made available, and the general observation that you see is that transcription factor binding sites show an enrichment, whether you look at rates compared to the flanks or in this case versus a control. However, the nature of these mutations is not rather clear. So here are the same mutations, but sort of looking at how they impact binding, and there's no clear directionality to whether they improve or decrease binding. And similarly, very few of these recurrent mutations actually show any sort of association with gene expression. And in, under specific cases, people have looked at selection measures for these regions and sort of been unable to find any evidence for the same. So a general overview in the community seems to be that mutations within these sites probably come from some underlying processes rather than from selection by the cancer cell. And so one of the questions that we're interested in is, where could these mutations come from? And so mismatches are a common source of mutations. So DNA mismatches are basically non-complementary base pairs, so an A with a C here, a T paired with a G here, that arise during aberrant DNA processes. So that could be replication errors, or in case of the TG mismatch, just a spontaneous deamination. And over 66% of cancer mutations actually are attributed to errors in replication. And recent work in the field has sort of looked at competition between transcription factor and repair and attributed mutations to these. Here's just like a diagrammatic representation. So assume you have a GT mismatch here. In a normal circumstance, you see a repair enzyme sort of correct that error. But if a transcription factor sort of protects that site, then maybe the repair enzyme can no longer access it, and upon replication, this unrepaired mismatch leads to a mutation. And so there was work out of Nuria Lopez's lab in Barcelona that recently looked at repair and transcription factor binding sites. Oops. And so you see a clear decrease in repair in these sites and an increase in mutation rates from the same. I'd like to mention that this work looked at repair in UV damage, whereas we're talking about mismatches here, but a similar analogy could be drawn out for the same. And another similar process that creates a lot of mutations and mismatches is the Pol alpha replication of the lagging strand. So Pol alpha is an error-prone polymerase that increases the rate of mismatches in the lagging strand. But in a normal cell, these are usually replaced by the Pol delta, which can just displace the strand that the Pol alpha synthesized. But again, there was work recently that suggested that if a transcription factor binds here, then this can, displacement activity can be blocked. And as a result, you see this mismatch be protected and in a similar fashion lead to a mutation. So the question that we wanted to ask here is, does this binding occur in the first place? And the reason to sort of doubt that is because mismatches affect both the sequence and the shape of the DNA. So here are some Watson-Crick base pairs on the left and some mismatched sequences on the right. And as you can see, just changing the base does change the nature of the functional groups that are available. So these are typically what the transcription factor will interact with. And by changing the base on one strand, you do sort of change the nature of that interaction. But more importantly, you also change the shape locally. So in some cases, you can either bring the diameter of the DNA closer or create a local kinks. And since both sequence and shape are key determinants of protein DNA binding, we do expect these mismatches to sort of show a different landscape of binding. However, there are no methods right now that can let us map this. So our lab recently developed a high throughput measurement where we use protein binding microarrays to characterize this binding. And briefly, the way we look at it is, so you can take any site from the genome, you keep one strand sort of as a reference strand constant, And in the other side, you generate multiple variants where you introduce mismatches compared to this side, so a non-complementary base here or here, and so on. And you do this for all the positions within this side, plus all possible mismatches for a given side. And once you've done that, you sort of print these variants on this chip, and you can use the reference strand as a pool of oligos. So you start with single-stranded DNA that has all possible variants in every position, and once you hybridize it, you sort of get double-stranded DNA that now has a single base pair mismatch. And once you add protein to it, you can then pull that out and measure the signal. And this assay was designed by Arya Lafik, who's a postdoc in our lab, and he carried out most of the experiments that I'm going to discuss today. And here's what the data usually looks like. So this is example of our results for ETS1, but we do this visualization for pretty much every protein we test. And at the bottom here, you have the constant strand that I was talking about, so the one that goes into these oligos. At the top, we have the strand with the mismatches, so we start with this side, but say at this position, we introduce all the possible mismatches compared to this strand. And what we compare to always is the parent strand, so every mismatched strand can give us a protein signal readout that can then be compared against this wild type. And so anything above this zero line here is something that shows increased binding, whereas things below that are show decrease in binding. So these are just, for example, that's a mismatch at the eighth position in the motif that will decrease binding, and most of these in the center, sorry, increase binding, and most of these in the center sort of decrease binding. And important to note is that mismatches and mutations have distinct effects. So this is the same data in the previous slide, but now we also generated mutations for the same site and sort of look at what they do to binding. So here were the mismatches that tend to increase binding, but when you look at the mutations in the same positions, the same base changes don't increase binding. So this doesn't come from base recognition alone, which does play a role in this process, but it's not the only determinant. And similarly, the mutations that increase binding, the corresponding mismatches don't. And if you use just mutations as a predictor of mismatch binding, you don't really get good correlation. So the idea here is that you really need to look at signals from this assay to figure out which mismatches in the cell would actually be contenders for protein binding. And we sort of tested this effect for a bunch of TFs across multiple structural families. Here's just a high-level representation of the data where, similarly, we're taking a motif and making changes everywhere, but sort of the key thing, without going into details that we want to focus on, is that every transcription factor showed at least one mismatch that had binding that was actually stronger than the site that the protein usually recognizes, which was quite surprising. And 30% of all mismatches either increased or retained binding. So these are the mismatches that we would expect actually to be bound by the cell, bound by the transcription factor within the cell, instead of just assuming, as current studies do, that every mismatch similar to the mutation would bind. And interestingly, mismatches can also create binding sites from completely non-specific sequences. So this is data for ETS again, where we start with this wild type that has no known ETS site. We also had some negative controls on this experiment, so we got a range of non-specific binding, but we also had a couple of specific sites within the same to just gauge how far this site away was from specificity. And when you take mutations within this site, you don't see, you don't cross that level of non-specificity, so it's still far away from being specific. But if at the same position, instead of introducing the mutation, you introduce a mismatch, then you see quite strong binding that reaches those levels of specificity for this strong ETS site. And so this effect, like I mentioned before, can't be attributed to sequence alone and has more to do with sort of the shapes and distortions that the mismatch is creating. And these actually allow us to figure out what the nature of protein DNA binding is as far as the conformational penalties are concerned, which is work that we talk about in our preprint. But today, I'd like to focus less on that and coming back to the story with repair. So here's the same sort of cartoon that we talked about earlier. So now the question we wanted to answer is was can this step occur? And so we find that it can, but existing maps don't help us figure out which ones they'd be. So we sort of want to use our data for figuring out which mismatches would be bound in this fashion. But we're still far away from figuring out if this would lead to this. And the reason for that is that there are a number of other processes that are involved here. For example, you need to model the rate of generation of mismatches. You need to model the rate of repair for these. And you need to also model the specificity of repair enzymes in the first place. And so what we have characterized is essentially this affinity in multiple sequence contexts. But we're still far away from sort of building a model that can fully specify this process. So the question we wanted to ask was, because a lot of this data is either heterogeneous or unknown, can we leverage any data that exists right now without fully specifying this model? So sort of to suggest what directions we should go in. And to do that, we looked at somatic mutations in cancer again, focusing on a transcription factor called MYC. And one of the reasons to do this was because MYC is upregulated in most cancers. And so it's likely to be present in most tumor cells, regardless of tumor type. Our data suggested that if you take this CACGCG site, which is actually a weak MYC binding site, and introduce a TG mismatch, you can increase binding to quite significant levels. And so this is how that mismatch would occur. So you have the sigmoid that has a CG at this position, either during a replication error or during methylation with spontaneous deamination, this can become a TG mismatch. And then, as we discussed in the previous slide, a transcription factor, in this case MYC, might bind here and then lead to this TA mutation upon replication when the repair enzyme fails to correct it. So sort of the expectation, if our hypothesis makes sense, is that we'll see an enrichment of C to T mutations at this location within this context, because c-MYC binding will impede repair. And before we do that analysis, though, we need to talk about controls. And the reason for that is that mutation counts can be very heterogeneous, so they can vary with sort of the mutation type, but also, importantly, the mutation context. So in this case, we want to compare like for like. So we compare mutations in the C to a T, again with a C to a T, and in a similar context. So sort of keeping these four bases constant, but just changing the bases at the front. So here you have these two sites, one on the left and one on the right, both of which can incorporate a mismatch. But in the case on the left, you see MYC actually binding to that site, whereas in the case on the right, unless those NNs are CA, you won't see MYC binding. And then the expectation is that while the right would be corrected by a repair enzyme in the way that it normally is, according to our hypothesis, the repair enzyme won't correct the mismatch that's bound by MYC, which would lead to a TA mutation in the MYC bound site versus no mutation in the normal site. And so the expectation is that within this context, you should see an enrichment for these mutations, whereas in the other case, you shouldn't see any enrichment. And so to do this analysis, we looked at mutation calls from around 1,900 tumors across multiple cancer types and looked at mutations within the non-coding regions. So we looked at mutations for C to T within this context and within C to T again within this context. And so we find a striking enrichment of mutations in the case that is bound here on the right, here on the left in red versus the control case in blue. And the way to do this is, like, we do this in a very simple fashion where we just model this as a hypergeometric distribution. So you sort of have a larger set of sites from which you pull a subset of bound sites, and so you sort of look if the number of mutations that you see is significant, assuming that they come from the same population. And so this suggests that MYC binding does lead to mutations in some way, but is it really tied to repair is a question that this doesn't really answer yet. And so we like to tie in repair to this now. So we start with the same site, and now look at the case where repair is absent. So in this case, while you see binding occur again on the left, but no binding on the right, both of these actually lead to mutations just because there are no repair enzymes right now that are correcting either of these. And so the expectation here is that without repair enzymes, you should not see this enrichment, which makes sense. But the way to test this is by looking at cancers that have deficient repair. So repair is still present, but it's much weaker. So we expect this enrichment to either go away or sort of be depleted. And these tumors are usually called MSI or MSIH because they're characterized by something called a high microsatellite instability. And so the results, when we do that, this is the same slide as before. So all these tumors had functional repair. They should have shown the bound mismatch to be enriched, which they did. But now when we look at the same comparison, but in a case where repair is now dysfunctional, that enrichment does go away. And so this supports our claim and strongly suggests that MYC binding leads to mutations, but is likely to come from competition with repair and not through binding alone, which is what our hypothesis suggested. And so the next step for us now is to try and test these for different transcription factors in different sequence contexts. And just to summarize here, so mutations in transcription factor binding sites, despite enrichment, may not be functional and are hypothesized to come from repair, but right now there's very little data on how transcription factors bind to damaged sites. Here we focus on mismatches and present an assay that can characterize this effect, see that it has widespread effects, and analyze mutation data to support the hypothesis that mismatches that are bound by transcription factors could cause mutations through competition with repair. And so the idea is that whenever you're doing sort of a driver analysis, you would want to weed the ones out that are born from some underlying process rather than selection. And I'd like to thank members of the Gordon Lab, specifically my advisor, Raluca Gordon, and Arya Lafek, who designed the assay and did the experiments. I'd also like to thank members of the Al-Hashimi Lab, who worked with us more on the structural characterization of this effect, sort of to figure out why these mismatches would lead to increases, with more about which you can read in the preprint, and I'm happy to talk about afterwards, and the sources of funding. And so thank you, and thanks to the audience again.
We can take a few questions, Julia.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
So you were saying that the mismatch is affecting the DNA shape.
Yeah.
But I'm wondering whether sort of an obvious hypothesis would be that the bases, you know, often flip out.
Uh-huh.
And so whether that's something that a transcription factor could bind directly, is there anything known about that?
So you mean just the flipped out?
Yeah,
so
Hochstein or whatever that's called. That happens apparently when DNA crosslinks.
Yeah. So I don't know of any evidence that directly tests that claim, but even the shape effects themselves are quite heterogeneous. So while in some cases the bases might flip out like you suggest, other cases actually either have less severe impacts on the local shape or in some cases more severe impacts. So the way that mismatches affect binding is sort of not the same for every mismatch and sort of needs to be characterized in more particular fashion given the transcription factor. And so we usually look at mechanisms of how that transcription factor binds protein in the first place and see if the mismatch sort of mimics that in any fashion. And one of the things that we've seen is that a lot of mismatches that increase affinity tend to mimic the form of the distorted form. So like when the protein binds, it distorts the DNA. But if the mismatch can pre-distort the DNA, it can increase affinity for the protein because it no longer does their work. So that effect is sort of heterogeneous across proteins and mismatches.
Thank you. So this is the end of the morning session. We will meet back here at 2. Right now, this room is needed for some other meeting. So please thank the speaker, and thank you all.